keeping us from our sins. In the name of Jesus. Father, we want to come thank you for just life and health and strength, Father. Oh, Father, 2017 wasn't good for us, Father. But we still thank you.
to my pastor, Pastor Hill, to all of my co-labors, and to you, the awaiting congregation. Seems like it's a good day.
Amen.
I think that was a little quiet. I say, I seem like it's a good day. To do anything. Especially when you can have children. It's a good day. We're not going to belong the time. We thank our choir for that wonderful selection. We're going to have our response of reading. Our Reverend Adonai, song of praise. Then our tithe and offering. Then our altar prayer. I'll have another time. I'll be back.
Shall I say amen?
Amen.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Our response to reading this morning comes from Psalms, the 34th division.
All right.
Psalms, the 34th division. Amen. Say amen. Verses 1 through 14. Psalms 34 division, verses 1 through 14. Amen. And the word of God reads, I will bless the Lord at all times.
All right.
His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together.
I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and delivered me from all my enemies.
They looked unto him, and were lightened, and their faces were not ashamed.
This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him, and saved him out of all his troubles.
The angel of the Lord encamped around about them that feared him, and delivered them. Oh, fear the Lord, ye his saints. There is no want to them that fear him. Come, ye children, hearken unto me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord.
Keep thy tongue from evil,
and thy lips from speaking God together. Depart from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. Amen. Take God and a blessing to heal, readers, and obey us for this word.
Thank you. be something.
All right.
And it wasn't because of nothing that I done. But it's all about Jesus. He looked for y'all, my folks, and saw my daily need. Oh, I'm glad about it. I'm glad to be in the house today. If any day that I would want to be in the house would be today.
All right.
He's good all the time.
come to you with thanksgiving this morning. We come to you as humble as you know how. We come, Lord, thanking you that you have blessed us to come to the end of another year. And our prayer is that you may bless each and every one of us to celebrate the coming of a new year. And we pray, God, that if it's your will, word today. for a day like this. There's something about church and all of those that make me sick. All of the reading families throughout this country, throughout this world. Let them know that you all know that you promised that you'll never leave us and always be the same. But you said you'd be with us always, and you'll be to the end. I thank on your word, Lord. I trust your word and I believe your word, God. I know that you're with us. That's great, my people. That we may be spiritually strong, and that we may be mighty witnesses in the community. And so, Lord, we want to come and fellowship with us and join in this mission.
Thank you, son. That's That's all right.
I thank God I'm still here. I've been here for the whole month.
Amen.
And I am happy as I can be.
All right.
excited to be here. First, give it all to God. Pastor Hill, all the other ministers on the roster, my brothers and sisters in Christ, I'm just glad to be here. You know, without a doubt, God brought me through another year. But God saw fit to let me be in the church house on December 31st, 2017. You know what? I'm really grateful. I'm just honored to be on God's program. I'm just honored to be one of God's children because it don't come easy. We gonna have some ups and downs. But we just have to keep rolling on. We can't give in to our challenges. Right. I'm going to talk to you all just for a brief moment today on, I'm going to try. God, it's all in your hands. Lord, don't let me speak. You speak. Because you are my, I'm your mouthpiece today. I'm a living Savior. And when I speak of our living Savior, I can really speak of my living Savior. And you know, we need to make that a personal issue and say, my living Savior. My family was called to say that, but Sister Bell and Brother Bell would know that she's not going to make it tonight, but here I sit today because of my living Savior. That's how you need to look at that. When you're going through stuff and you think you can't handle it, be not conformed to this world, this Lord. this world.
That's all right.
But you know, God created the heavens and the earth, and this world belongs to him. So if he's our living sacrifice, and he's telling us that we should let our body, he created us, be a living sacrifice. It said, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Now, I'm going to speak to you briefly, and I did say briefly, so I'm going to make sure that my sisters always tell me, be brief. They are my daughters say, Mama, it's a mission program. So I'm going to try to remember that, because when you start speaking the word of God and you start feeling the word of God, you're no longer, you can't contain yourself, baby. I can't contain myself. My hands go to doing this, and my one foot go to doing something else, and I just get excited, because that's what the word of God will do for you. And will excite you. It will make you feel good. You'll go off feeling, oh, Lord God, you did it again. Because you know what? First, we have to get out of ourselves. Wait. Oh, my whole prayer was, God, move me. Don't let me speak. Just use my mouth. That's all I want him to do today, is use my mouth. It said, God has no respect of person. No respect of person. He can use me, he can use that baby. And I've seen him use people. Unbeknownst to themselves, God is using you. You sometimes see the only Bible. So God, the way we act, the way we present ourselves is what God is looking for out of all of us. We go off the kill sometimes. We all do. We all guilty because we said there is none right. We are all sinners. We are all sinners. We are all sinners. We were born in sin. We can try to do better. We want to be better, but it's not easy. Because there's an everyday challenge.
Amen.
I always say, God, this is my challenge. And sometimes I go, God, shut me up. You ever tell you, ask God to shut you up? I've had to say, God, just shut me down today. I've even said, God, if you need to, just choke me. Because sometimes we feel like we just, I just got to say it. But we need to say, God, control our mouth, our tongue. The nastiest little sharpest thing in our mouth gets us in the biggest trouble.
Yes.
So God, he has no respect for person. We all have a duty. In Sunday school this morning, it was talking about the Ephesians and being kind, what Paul had written to the Ephesians, to be kind, we should love one another, we should come together in unity.
Yes.
You know, and that's what we should do every day. Amen. We should thank God for each other.
We should
thank God for each other. Everybody should. We know that everybody's not going to be your friend, you can love everybody. Sometimes my mother had a phrase that she would say, you have to treat some people with a longhouse coat. But you know what? Sometimes you have to do that. And God will allow us to do that. He said, but he don't want us to just continue in sin. God don't want us to do that. It says here that God has no respect of person. And so God says that what Paul was telling the Corinthians, not the Corinthians, I'm getting off, what Paul was telling the Romans and the Jews is that the wise, we have to accept people, the wise, the foolish, the educated, the non-educated. You know, they put you in a basket and set you on the sideline. We would that they don't look like me today, they don't talk like me, they don't sound like me, but that's not godly. God wants us to do better. And that's what Paul is trying to teach the people. It's that God has a plan for our life.
Yes.
Each of us has a plan, and with that plan, he gives us
instruction every time we pick up the B-I-B-L-D. The word of God is here to tell you how to handle any situation that you're going through. So you need to just pick up your Bible and go by. And sometimes you open it up and you start crying. I have. I don't know if you have, but I'm like, oh God, I didn't know I was that bad. And sometimes we have to, but you don't have to recognize yourself. That's the first thing you have to do, is you have to recognize yourself. It says that everybody, when God can have a plan, we have to be in tune to God. We have to have a listening ear. We have to know when God is speaking. But we have to know how to have that discernment of spirit and that discernment of voice. A lot of times I used to ask my children, who you listening to?
All right.
Who you listening to? Right. We need, when sometimes we need to ask God that. Who you listening to? God, I'm sure he looks down and looks and says, who they listening to?
Yes,
right. God wants to listen to him. And you know what? He will speak to you. He will speak to you. I'm a living witness. He will speak to you. You might not know that it was God until a lot of times it's all over. You go, oh, thank you, God. You know, God is that he's that God for God. That's just the way he is. It's that I have a relationship with God. It's all I'm asking. All we have to do is ask God. That's how I believe in the baby, y'all.
That's right.
That's the one that went to the cross for. But all we have to do is say, God, I need you. God, I want you. God, you are my Savior. I say it every day. Larry said, who are you talking to? That's my husband. I said, I'm talking to God. But you know what, when I'm going through things, the first thing I say is, can I speak to you, please? Because we broke.
That's right.
We are broke. We need God to put us back on track, because we do get off key sometimes. We really do. It said, but when Paul was teaching the gospel, he went through all kinds of headaches and strife, and people didn't believe, that was undercurrent. And on every hand, he felt it all. But he never stopped talking from prison.
That's right.
All right.
He speak from prison. Most of Paul's sermon came from prison. So you know what, God can use you anyway. Anytime. As long as you are his mouthpiece and his words are going forth. It says, we shouldn't be ashamed. People are going to talk about you.
That's right.
Ooh, look at that holy rolling. I knew it myself. You know, we all guilty. You know, don't try to say, girl, I don't do that. Yes, you do. We all do it. We all do it. But you know what? Be grateful that you are. Because you have been set aside.
All right.
God is in the process of using you. And if you ain't been through nothing, you know, God, you used to hear him say, God got to give you a testimony. And God will give you a testimony. And when God gives you something to tell, but he done gave me a whole lot to tell. And I know people sick of hearing it, but I enjoy telling.
All right. All right. All right.
I know, you know, when God has done something for you, you have to tell. I have to be a witness. Nobody would know but me if I don't tell. But God allowed me to lay in a bed for 2 years in a hospital, for 2 years, just so I could come out and tell somebody. God allowed me to lose my mind because it was God. Hell told her daddy the other day, daddy, mama talking crazy. Do we need to take her to the hospital? Two strokes. But there is a God. The last
just cry like a baby. Mama gone. That's how you felt.
But you know what? Look at God.
I say him today.
Thank you for letting me be funny for you today. Sister Green. Testimony. Our living Savior, and she transformed it into her living Savior. Next on program, we have special guest singing group, Women of Praise. By the Jarvis Church, Pastor Carol Marshall.
Give God another hand, praise. Isn't he good? And we all here safe looking at each other, everybody looking at me. Because God is so good. Yes. Talking about God can do anything. You got to trust and believe that he can. Our first time thank God can.
All right.
We got to help us put your hand together.
God can, I know that he will. God will
anything else for you.
Hallelujah.
I tell you.
Come on.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
If the Lord never does anything else for me, He's done enough. Once, and he blessed me twice. but I wrote it, didn't I?
That's all right.
I'm going to pray to God.
That's all right.
This morning when I rose up, I didn't have no doubt. Oh, this morning when I rose up, I didn't have no doubt. Oh, this morning when I rose up, I didn't have no doubt. I know the Lord is taking care of me. I know the Lord.
Alright. No.
You're no stranger around here. You've been here a few times.
Alright.
Now you done made his way back. None other than the Church of the Living God.
Alright.
Mission. Sugarland, Texas. We're gonna present to some and introduce others. None other than the Reverend Raymond Smith. We just thank God for this opportunity to be in the midst here at Greater Mount Pilgrim. I just want to say, as I was sitting there and thinking, I just want to say, Greater Mount Pilgrim, thank you.
Amen.
For the 10 years that God had me here to groom me, to shape me into what He wanted me to be.
Amen.
Not what I wanted to be, or what my wife wanted me to be, or what my mother wanted me to be, or even what Greater Mount Pilgrim wanted me to be. But what God wanted me to be. So I just say thank you, you know, as I sit here and I just reminisce being here with Pastor Curtis and sitting under his leadership. It was an honor, a privilege, and a blessing just to pass through this way. And we're all on a journey, you know.
All right. Speak.
We're all on a journey. Let us pray. Precious Father, in the name of thy Son, Jesus Christ. Father, we just come right now, Father, calling up on your Holy Spirit. Let your Holy Spirit have its perfect work, O Father. Give us the words from on high, O Father. Touch hearts. Touch minds right now, Father. Touch whoever may be hurting right now, Father. Give them comfort. Give them peace. Prepare those who might not be hurting right now, but when the time does come, that they already have that comfort, Father. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my strength, that is my prayer. Amen. Let's just get a lot of hands up. Praise the Lord. My wife sends her love to each and every one of you. She was prepared to come this morning, but she woke up coughing. Just some things going on. But she sends her love. We thank God for her. We thank God that we're able to have a couple of the brothers to be with us here today. Brother Eric and Brother Norman. Amen.
Amen.
But more importantly, we thank God that the Holy Spirit's here with us. Because that is what we definitely need. We would not hold you long. If you have your Bibles, I ask that you would turn with me to the book of Acts. Acts chapter 27. As I was listening to Reverend Hill's mother-in-law, how she mentioned of the fact that in Sunday school, when Reverend Hadnot and Sister Ellis were putting together and giving her some insight
into what she was going to speak on this morning. I had to let Reverend Hill know that his mother-in-law was actually putting together what God had given me this morning. So we thank God for his Holy Spirit. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. If you're there, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. If you look with me at verse 9. We're going to read verse 9 and then we're going to go to verse 10. And from there, we're going to go over to verse 20 to 25. Amen? And the word of God reads, "Now when much time was spent, and when sailing was now dangerous, because the fast was now already past, Paul admonished them and said unto them, Sirs, I perceive that this voyage will be with hurt and much damage, not only of the lading and ship, but also of our lives." Verse 20. "And when neither sun nor sun nor stars in many days appeared, and no small tempest lay on us, all hope that we should be saved was then taken away. But after long abstinence, Paul stood forth in the midst of them and said, Sirs, ye should have hearkened unto me and not have loosed from Crete, and to have gained this harm and loss. And now I exhort you to be of good cheer, for there shall be no loss of any man life among you, but of the ship. For there stood by me this night the angel of God, whose I am, and whom I serve, saying, Fear not, Paul, for thou must be brought before Caesar, and lo, God hath given thee all them that sail with thee. Wherefore, sirs, be of good cheer. For I believe God that it shall be even as it was told to me." Amen. You may be seated at this time. Hallelujah. If you don't mind, I'd like to talk to you with the topic that the Holy Spirit gave. God is able.
Amen.
God is able. Here in this book of Acts, chapter 27, just to rewind it a little bit, we have been looking at the whole book of Acts, and we have been looking at the power of the Holy Spirit. And we've been looking at the power of the Holy Spirit in the book of Acts as to how the Holy Spirit had began to lead and guide the disciples that Jesus had called to the fold to go forth in the ministry to do the work that they had, that he had called them to do. Then Paul, as we know, Paul at that time, his name was Saul, before he came under the power of the Holy Spirit, he was on a voyage
persecuting the church, killing the Christians, imprisoning them, thinking that he was doing God a favor because of his belief as a sold-out Sadducee, a sold-out Pharisee. He was sold out to his religion that he thought what he was doing was right, but all the time it was contrary to Jesus Christ. Paul eventually got converted. And being converted, Paul had been designated for a purpose for God. And being designated for that purpose for God, God put him on a journey to let him know that this is what I need you to do, to share the gospel to the Gentiles, to share the gospel about Jesus Christ, to share about what Jesus Christ has done in your life, to be a testimony about Jesus Christ going into the grave and raising up on the third day because of God putting a call on his life. Here in this chapter 27, Paul had came to the point where he needed to be on his journey to get to Caesar. And in order for him to get to his journey to Caesar, he had to travel by ship. And with him traveling by ship, if you read the chapter 27, they had encountered a storm on this ship. And it lets me know that on our Christian journey in this life, that we're all going to encounter storms in our lives. We're encountering this storm. And the thing about this storm, it was just not your ordinary storm that he encountered on this ship. Because you got to understand, when we come into the Christian fold, when God calls us to be on that journey for him, we're not just going to encounter ordinary storms. But we're going to encounter storms that are going to make us stop and think and doubt whether or not if we're saved, whether or not if we're on the right track, if we're going in the right direction for God, because we can't seem to see our way through that storm. Paul, when he encountered this storm, it was classified as a cyclops type of storm. A northeastern type wind came in and troubled the waters beyond imagination. And with that happening, I saw in scripture where I read where it talked about they were in this storm for so many days. Some of us get into storms and we want to get out of the storm the next day, or the next hour, or the next 5 minutes, or the next second, we want to get out of that storm. But Paul and I were in this storm for 14 days. Being in this storm, Paul, as we read, began to inform them of the fact that this ain't your ordinary storm. And he tried to enlighten them of the fact that let's just kind of stay where we at right now. But I read and I saw something where I wrote after I saw that where Paul kind of leaned into his own understanding and wanted to try to take matters into his own hand. But as I studied and looked at this, Paul had a journey that he had to go on to accomplish for God. It says that it was determined by the counsel of God before it was determined by the counsel of Phidias. And Phidias was the one when they did the judgment on Paul. And Phidias had decided that Paul, since he asked the warning to go see Caesar, therefore Phidias said, well, we're going to send Paul to go see Caesar. But as I read and studied, God had already orchestrated the fact that it's not because of Phidias said that Paul needed to go see Caesar, but it's the fact that God had already put it in place that Paul needed to go see Caesar. So I'm reminded of the fact that I've heard it said that God went to the end of our lives and came back to the beginning. So God has already orchestrated our lives. Even though we might try to twerk this and twerk that, but God will twerk it right back to where his plan is. It was determined by the counsel of God before it was determined by the counsel of Phidias that Paul should go to Rome. For God had work for him to do there. The course they steered and the places they touched at are here set down. It lets me know that God already has our designated places already set up. It is no accident that we are all here today. I thank Pastor Hill and giving glory and honor and praise unto Pastor Hill for allowing God to touch his heart for me to come back to preach here at Greater Mount Pilgrim. But God had already orchestrated it in his plan way before Pastor Hill was even born. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Those who launch forth on the ocean of this world with fair gale know that storms may meet with you, and therefore must not easily take it for granted that they have attained their purpose. Let us never expect to be quite safe till we enter heaven. We're gonna have troubles to the day until we get exactly. So don't let nobody tell you when you become a Christian that everything become easy. Because they tell you if you become a Christian that it become easy, something is wrong with their theology. Something is wrong with their doctrine. But Jesus said, in this life you shall have trials and tribulations. But he said, be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. It says that they saw neither the sun nor the stars for many days.
All right.
It was dark time. It was dark times. There was troubles. Like I told you, many of us, when we get into a storm, we want to get out within that second, or within that minute, or within that hour. But it lets me know that storms don't always just easily go. The storms sometimes just hang around just to see how you're going to respond as to how you're going to act to the situation. Sometimes you just might have to just say, hallelujah, Lord. I thank you for the storm, Lord. Because sometimes God hears that and says, okay, I'm going to go ahead and move the storm. But then sometimes God says, no, I'm just going to let them stay in the storm a little bit longer. Keep them in the oven. It ain't like, you know, you put that turkey in the oven, it takes a while before it gets done. God has us in the oven. It takes some time before we get done. Then he takes us out that we'll be able to be served to somebody else. You know we're being served to somebody else. We're not, We're not just being saved just for ourselves, but we're being saved for somebody else. They're enlightening somebody else about the things of God. Enlighten somebody else about the things that God can do for them just like they did for me.
All right.
Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let us, as I said, never expect to be quite safe till we enter heaven. Sometimes it's a condition of the people of God as their spiritual matters, they walk in darkness and have no light. We're talking about those who are not saved. They're walking in spiritual darkness and being deceived by the things of the world. Thinking that they're saved, but they're not saved. As man, this is something that opened up my ears and my heart and my mind when I saw this and I started putting it together and making it fit. It said, any man would rather make shipwreck of his goods than his life. But many rather make shipwreck of their faith and a good conscience than of their goods. Most people bring themselves into trouble because they do not know what when they are well off. They come to harm and lose by amending to mend their condition, often against advice. And that goes back to the point when Paul gave them some advice about what was going to take place. But they didn't listen. But if you go back there and you read in that verse number 11, when Paul told them about what was going to take place, that we should stay here, but it says that verse 11 said, nevertheless, the centurion believed the master and the owner of the ship more than those things which was spoken by Paul. Sometimes, Pastor Hill, they ain't gonna listen to what you say. They ain't gonna believe what you say. But sometimes they wanna have evidence of their own and do it their own way. We live in a world today where I wanna do it my own way. I wanna see what the result's gonna be because I don't need nobody telling me what to do. I had to learn that in the Marine Corps, Deacon Bell. I had to learn to let them tell me what to do, how to do it, what time to get up, what time to go to sleep, how to wash my clothes, how to shave my face, how to take a shower. I had to learn how to listen to somebody else's advice. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Looking back at Paul, Paul made a relation to God. You come to find out that no storms or tempests can hinder God's favor to his people. For he is a help always at hand.
All right.
It is a comfort to the faithful servant of God when in difficulties that as long as the Lord has any work for them to do, their lives can be prolonged. God is preserving us for his purpose, for his glory, for his honor, and for his work. We can't keep ourselves, but he's keeping us for what he wants us. You know, as a Christian, we are obligated to God. You're no longer your own. Gotta get that in your spirit. Everything that I do it for God. I don't do it for me.
but I do it for God, because it just said there that God prolongs our lives to do the things that he needs us to do. But when we stray away and start doing our own thing, then there is an end result. I'll let you think about that. He says, if God has chosen us to salvation, he has also appointed that we should obtain it by repentance, faith, prayer, persevering obedience. It is fatal presumption to expect it in any other way. It is an encouragement to people to commit themselves to Christ as their Savior. When those who invite them clearly show that they do so themselves. So it goes to say that in order for you to tell somebody about Christ, you got to have Christ in your life. You got to show evidence that you have Christ in your life. How can you tell somebody about being saved and you ain't saved yourself? Hallelujah. The ship that Paul was on was in a storm.
All right.
This old body, this old ship that I'm in, I'm in a storm. It says that today we are that ship in a storm. Some of you might be sitting there and saying, I ain't in no storm. What are you talking about? I ain't in no storm. Ain't nothing going on. But if you really be honest with yourself, if you be truthful to yourself, not only to yourself, but if you be truthful to God, and you let God search your heart, and let God point out those things in your life that need to be dealt with, those things are classified as storms in your life. Bible says we are not to lean to our own understanding, but in all our ways we are to acknowledge him, and he shall direct our path. We need to get away from wanting to direct our own path, but we are to let God, Holy Spirit, guide us in the way that he would have us to go. Hallelujah. It says that, and I want to go over this again, just to make sure we get this. The ship that Paul was on was in a storm. Today we are that ship in a storm. If the heart fixes itself to the world,
all right,
it shall be lost. Let's say that again. If the heart fixes itself to the world, it shall be lost. Satan's temptations continually beat against us as Christians. Though there is a great difficulty in the way of the promised salvation, it shall without fail be brought to pass. It will come to pass that whatever the trials and dangers may be in our lives, in due time all believers will get safely to heaven. Let me say again, in due time all believers will get safely to heaven.
All right.
The Lord Jesus, thou hast assured us that none of thine shall perish, because God has said in his word,
yes, sir,
that he is able.
Yes,
you say, preacher, well, how do you know God says that he's able?
All right.
Because he said it in his word, and he's able. Well, he says in Matthew 3:39, God is able to create something out of nothing.
Yeah.
He says in 2 Corinthians 9:8, God is able to make grace, all grace abound to you.
Yeah.
He says in Daniel 3:17, God is able to deliver.
Yeah.
He says in 1 Corinthians 10:13, God is able to give you strength to rise above your trials. He said in Hebrews 7:25, God is able to save you.
He says in Acts 20 and 32, God is able to build up in grace. He said in 2 Chronicles 25 and 9, God is able to exceed your expectations. He's able to do exceedingly above all you can imagine. He says in Judges 1 and 24, God is able to keep you from falling. He says in 2 Timothy 1, 12 and 14, God is able to guard the good word in you, good deposit in you to keep you from error. He said in Romans 4 and 21, he said God is able to fulfill his promise. He said in 2 Corinthians 1 and 4, God is able to comfort those who are afflicted. I don't know about you today, but I read those scriptures, just some of the scriptures to let you know that God is able. I don't know what you're going through today. I don't know what you're experiencing today, but I know that God is able. Who are you going to trust? Are you going to trust what man say? Or are you going to trust what God says? Because God says he is able. I don't know about you today, but I'm going to trust God today. I'm going into 2018. I'm going into 2018, and I'm going to be like Paul. Paul said that I press to the mark of the high prize of calling in Jesus Christ. He said, I'm not going to look behind me, because what's behind me is already over. Ain't nothing I can do about what's behind me. Even though it's behind me, try to catch up with me. That means that I'm just going to run a little bit harder. I'm going to run a little bit faster. And say, like, get behind me, because you can't get in front of me no more, because it's all over me. Because I know what God says in his word. He said, if I trust him, he will guide me. He will lead me. He will keep me in his perfect peace. I don't know about you today, but I'm going to 2018. I'm going in with a peace that surpasses all understanding. When all hell breaks loose, when the hound dogs come out, when things don't go right in my job, when things don't look right in my bank account, I'm going to have peace, because I